Dan, are you there?
Yep, I'm here.
Fantastic. Dan, it's the fucking final, mate. It's the final.
It's been a bit of a journey, but we're there now.
We're there now, and it's the hottest show in the YouTube. Like, my phone's blowing up. You know, I got a text actually the other day from Winona Ryder. She's saying, big fan. And she can see this going to big things. You know, you've got to look at the two of us, Dan. DC Productions taking over, you know, the entire.
I quite like the sound of DC Productions.
It's an octopus. It's Sarah Green.
You too.
Sarah.
I was meant to be in this tournament. No, no, no. I can see you're about to talk. But just shut it, all right? We know that I would have completely ruled this tournament. We know I would have abolished Stephen Wilson, David Haughney, Ross McLeod, and all the other idiots that we've got in the ESSR. But I wasn't in it. I was not in it. David, what have you got to say for yourself?
I mean, I'm sorry.
No. Shut up. All right? I want my match. I want my bucket match. I don't care who it is. I don't care if it's your favourite person in the world, Gary. I don't care if it's that idiot Ross McLeod or, you know, the ginger pumpernickel that is Stephen Wilson. I want my match. Give it to me now.
Okay then.
Welcome to the final of the Book It tournament. It's me, the GOAT, David Campbell, happy to be here today to facilitate over this final. It's been a long road for both these competitors, but we will crown the very first winner of the Booker T. Rophy today. It is Stephen Wilson versus David Haughney, and the stakes couldn't be higher. You know, two very lifelong friends. These two have known each other for a very, very long time indeed now, and both of them have been cornerstones of this podcast since day one. Stephen running things at ESSR, Dave by his side through it all. The story writes itself, and neither of them have had an easy road to the final. David Haughney, of course, taking out Ryan Gallagher before moving on to victory against Ross McLeod. It was Stephen Wilson who had to go up against the wild card that was Grant McRobbie, and then he took down Strack and his PS4 presentations there. Very, very hard fought roads for both gentlemen. And, you know, as is befitting an occasion of like this, producer Daniel Campbell has put together a little video package to tell you what to expect today and to set up the story so far. So, Dan, take it away.
It appears as though our paths are set to meet once again in the final of the first ever Book It tournament.
An eight-man tournament to determine the first winner of the Booker T. Rophy.
Which really is a massive shame for you, as it will mean that once again, like any time we've crossed paths over the past 12 years, you playing second fiddle to me.
We have a lot of history together. Been through university, undergraduate degrees, master's degrees, countless hours of student volunteering, and even a few radio shows. Some good times. Some very good times.
When we hosted the Tables, Ladders and Tunes radio show, what was the first name that the listeners heard when they tuned in every week?
And welcome to Tables,
Ladders
and Tunes.
Oh my,
I'm Stephen Wilson.
And I'm David Haughney.
There's a reason that this podcast, Eat, Sleep, Suplex, Retweet, that the name above the door is Wilson.
You claim I've been living in your shadow these last few years while you've been riding off with all the success. Could be further from the truth.
A whole decade of you living in my shadow.
Everything you've achieved in these last few years, I've always been by your side, not in your shadow. I mean, just look at this podcast, for example. I don't think it would even got off the ground if you didn't have me to help.
There's a reason that I'm getting married and David's on the wedding party.
Someone, a helping hand, a lackey, people would say, escorting my guests to their seats where they'll get the best possible view of my big day.
He can comment on my appearance all he wants. I think the most important thing is I've been running roughshod in this booking tournament. You know, I put down Ryan Gallagher when it comes to booking NXT. I put Ross McLeod down when booking a tag team classic, and nobody suspected that I was going to win that.
I beat the guy that beat Scott. You know, that's a thing. You know, you beat a guy that beat Jack.
Both of you will be booking the Raw after WrestleMania.
I will be the first ever inaugural Booker T. Rophy winner.
We'll all be hearing the familiar line, Wilson beats Haughney. And that is an undisputed fact. Stats boy.
Thank you for that, Dan. The promos from both Stephen Wilson and David Haughney heating up as we get into the final today. I'm excited to get right into it. But before we do, don't forget to check out Eat Sleep Suplex Retweet on Spotify, iTunes, and all good podcasting sites. You can go and check out ESSR Central on a Thursday, which is our news show. We'll report on the week that was in wrestling. And, of course, the ESSR feature shows, which come out on Tuesdays. Check out all our other content on there, Saturday Draft Live, Eats Meets West, everything in between. Then check out what else we've got in this YouTube channel. We've got Quiz Showdown over there. A variety of guests, hosts, and quizzers appear on that. And, of course, the Conspiracy Theory with me, David Campbell, once a month, talking about a topic that's sure to get you buzzing. But without further ado, let's introduce our competitors for today. And introducing first, he is the founder of Eat Sleep Suplex Retweet. Please welcome Mr. Stephen Wilson. Stephen is here. Stephen is ready to go. Wow.
David Campbell, it's good to be here. Such a thrill. I cannot wait to do what I do all the time and stomp David Haughney to the ground.
To the ground. You seem very confident, and maybe you should be, because you had two very, very difficult opponents to get here. Grant McRobbie taking you to the limit when you had to book Evolution 2. That was a great one. And then against Strack as well. It was a really tough battle against Strack, who proved his mettle after beating Scott McLeod in the first round. So are you confident that you've beaten those two? Dave Haughney's just another stepping stone to the trophy.
Listen, David, to quote from my favourite movie character of all time, Arnold Schwarzenegger's Mr. Freeze, in this universe, there's only one absolute: Wilson beats Haughney.
I love it. I love it. But we can't just let you say this without giving him a chance to respond. So without further ado, introducing second, he is the inaugural ESSR champion of the world. He is one of the hosts of Saturday Draft Live. Please welcome David, the Statsman Haughney. Dave, it's good to see you here today. How are you feeling? Obviously, a different road than Stephen. You came up against Ryan Gallagher. It was a tough battle. The improved very much against Ross McLeod, managing to beat him in the end. Are you confident that you can keep up this upward trajectory and it's going to take you all the way to the trophy?
Hey, listen, nobody ever thought I would make it this far. And to be honest, I even surprised myself a couple of times. It just goes to show that I know how to book an NXT TakeOver and I know how to book a tag team classic, which is two aspects of wrestling that this podcast is very fond of. And I'm going to make it three in a row against this this guy I've known for a very long time, Stephen Wilson. And to borrow a quote from my favorite film of all time, Happy Gilmore, you're going to die, clown.
And there's been a lot of words, a lot of harsh words in that package that we saw earlier on. Dave, how do you react to Stephen saying, you know, you've always played second fiddle to him? Does that play on you mentally going into this match at all?
Not in the slightest, because like I said in that promo, he wouldn't be where he is today without me. And I'm just hoping that he can, you know, back up his claims of being a champion booker when he's actually facing me for once rather than having my assistance and my input.
Stephen, how do you respond to those comments from Dave?
Not much else I can say, David, as opposed to what I said. I said everything I wanted to say in that particular promo. It's like, there's a reason why it's the Wilson 2022 wedding, you know. You'll see David there, and he's just handing things out. He's just telling people, please sit there, please sit there. And after this is finished, I'll tell him to sit down and shut up, because I'm going to win this bucket tournament.
Well, listen, I did toss the coin, you know, in between recordings when I went for a pee, and it will be Mr. David Haughney who will be kicking things off today. Now, we will be booking the Raw after WrestleMania. The Raw after WrestleMania. 7 matches max, as always. 5 segments match, as always. Special conditions this time. You must have at least 1 championship match on that show. I need someone to return from injury at that show. And I also need a surprise, whether it be a return, a call-up, a defection, something along those lines. Just surprise me, people. That's all I ask of you. Gentlemen, are you ready? Dave, ask you first. Are you ready for this?
Let's do it.
Stephen, are you ready for this?
Tonight's forecast, a freeze is coming. I'm on it.
And as always, you each have 10 minutes to book your cards. David Haughney, your 10 minutes to book it. The Raw after WrestleMania for the booker, T. Rophy, starts now.
All right, so in the aftermath of WrestleMania, the first thing we see on Monday Night Raw is the Hurt Business opening the show. Lashley, against all odds, has retained against Drew McIntyre the WWE Championship. And MVP has opened the show boasting how great that the almighty Bobby Lashley is. Out of nowhere, out comes the United States champion, Matt Riddle. He says back at Elimination Chamber, he defeated Lashley for the US title and he can beat him again, only this time for the WWE title. So he challenges Bobby Lashley to a match for the title later on. But MVP interjects and says, no, this is going to be a non-title match instead. Sure, you can get your hands on Lashley, but it's not for the title. And then, second option, Riddle says he's actually got a couple of bros in the back who want to actually face his two lackeys, Cedric and Shelton. Now, Cedric, obviously being the very hastily decision maker that he is, he assumes it's going to be Lucha House Party. So he accepts the match on their behalf, very hastily. And who is it? Not Lucha House Party. It's the Viking Raiders. Yeah, so we see a surprise return from injury for Ivar and a return from paternity for Eric. And this opening match is basically a showcase of the Viking Raiders returning to their dominant ways. With a match of 8 minutes, 12 seconds, the winners of this match are the Viking Raiders. I mean, what a way to kick off the Raw after Mania. We then cut to our first segment of the night, and it is Adam Pearce in his office, and in comes Braun Strowman. Now, Braun is very satisfied that he has got his hands on Shane McMahon and he's now demanding a WWE title shot. Pearce then says, well, we've got a new pay-per-view we've got the next pay-per-view coming up, the Money in the Bank pay-per-view. So instead of just giving you the title match, you're going to earn your opportunity. So we're going to have 2 Money in the Bank qualifying matches tonight. The first is going to be Sheamus versus Damian Priest, and the second one will be AJ Styles versus Braun Strowman. That's going to be happening later on. Second match, and it's going to be for the Raw Women's Championship. So after capturing the Raw Women's Championship in a 6-pack challenge at WrestleMania, it is the new Raw Women's Champion, Rhea Ripley, who has issued an open challenge to any woman to face her one-on-one. Peyton Royce comes out and answers. Peyton Royce, after cutting that blistering promo on Raw Talk, has reiterated that she's no longer accepting being another face in the crowd. She is intent on making an example out of the new girl on Monday Night Raw. In a relatively solid 10 minutes, 2 seconds, you know, Peyton gives Rhea run for her money in the form of, you know, being trying to break out as a single star. But Rhea retains in 10 minutes, 2 seconds. Then we go into our third match straight away. It is the aforementioned Money in the Bank qualifier between Sheamus and Damian Priest. Quite a solid match that goes over a couple of commercial breaks, 15 minutes, 45 seconds. And in this match, Priest is receiving a lot of praise for taking the former four-time world champion to the limit. And after a hard-fought contest, Damian Priest hits the lights and gets the win and qualifies for the Money in the Bank ladder match. Moving into match four now, and it is going to be a rematch for the Women's Tag Team Championships. Now, Sasha and Bianca have won the Women's Tag Team title match at Fastlane, and they go into WrestleMania as opponents and as tag team champions, a la John Cena and Shawn Michaels at WrestleMania 23. And this is the point where Nia and Shayna get their rematch after losing. Now, Bianca is also the SmackDown Women's Champion after defeating Sasha at WrestleMania. This is a moment where Sasha ends up turning heel on Bianca Belair and just walks out on her, bitter that she lost to the EST at WrestleMania. And this results in Nia and Shayna becoming the first ever three-time Women's Tag Team Champions, clocking in at a solid match of 12 minutes and 30 seconds. So first ever three-time Women's Tag Team Champions, and now we've got a new angle to the Sasha-Bianca feud. Next segment, we have Kayla Braxton interviewing Drew McIntyre, who is still very much frustrated after failing to capture the WWE title at WrestleMania, and he is venting very heavily. Who shows up? The Miz and John Morrison. And before they get a word in, they get a single syllable in, Drew goes off his dinger and beats the living daylights out of them. He chases them down to ringside, attacks them with a steel chair. He claymores Morrison over the barricade, future shocks DDTs The Miz through the announce table, and starts to embrace his psychopath gimmick once again. And he's finally got his revenge for Miz cashing in on him at Elimination Chamber. So this is a new path for Drew and sort of revisiting an old character. Next match, it's the second Money in the Bank qualifier match. We have AJ Styles versus Braun Strowman, a proper high flyer versus powerhouse style match. Now, Strowman has got a bit of a second wind after getting a one-up over Shane McMahon, and he begins to go on the tear like he used to do. And in this match, AJ is actually on the verge of winning when all of a sudden New Day come out and cause a distraction because AJ and Omos beat them the night before for the Raw Tag Team titles. And as a result, Strowman capitalizes and gets the win and wins the Money in the Bank qualifier match at a time of 16 minutes, 22 seconds. Next segment, we cut to Elias and Jackson Ryker cutting a promo slash song in the ring when all of a sudden you hear three amazing words. Shock the system. Adam Cole has been called up from NXT after losing to Kyle O'Reilly at Stand and Deliver. And he goes in to confront Elias and Ryker. Elias sends Ryker to attack him and an impromptu match occurs. Next match, it's Adam Cole versus Jackson Ryker. Now, at first, Cole gets overpowered by the much stronger Ryker, but manages to outwit the big man with a flurry of his best moves, his cunning, hits him with a last shot, boom. 11 minutes, 16 seconds, winner is Adam Cole, baby. And then we immediately cut to our next segment, which is Adam Cole backstage with Adam Pearce, saying that he also demands to be in the Money in the Bank ladder match whilst going through all his NXT accolades. Pearce says he also has to earn his place in the ladder match, so instead he's going to be facing Elias next week in a Money in the Bank qualifier match. So that's set for next week. Then we cut to our main event, which is the aforementioned at the start of the show, Bobby Lashley versus Matt Riddle in a champion versus champion match. Now, this is a very hard-hitting back-and-forth contest between the two. Riddle narrowly avoids the Hurt Lock several times. Riddle looks like he's on the verge of winning, but then MVP pulls the referee out the ring. Cedric and Shelton attack out of nowhere, and the match is ruled as a no contest. But here's the closer, because the match clocks in at 18 minutes, 41 seconds. This is a very good chunk of the programming. But in closing, whilst Riddle is being attacked by the Hurt Business, who returns to make the save? Keith Lee. He's been on the shelf for 2 months because of the Hurt Business and gets ready to charge the Hurt Business. But instead, he does a swerve and attacks Matt Riddle instead. He hits all his big moves on Riddle, including the Spirit Bomb and a couple of others. Closing shot of the Raw after Mania, Keith Lee is standing tall with the Hurt Business, and they've just gained a massive acquisition.
A very massive acquisition indeed. Dave, thank you very much for booking your Raw after Mania. We will be picking holes in it, you know, when the time comes. But until then, it's time to move over to the other side of this thing. It's Mr. Stephen Wilson booking his Raw after Mania for his shot to become the first ever holder of the Booker T. Rophy. Stephen, are you ready? You're muted, Stephen. Are you ready?
I am ready now.
And with that, without a hitch, your 10 minutes, Stephen, starts now.
Well, welcome to this Raw after Mania. We get the usual pyrotechnics as the commentary team tell us what's coming up tonight. We've got a rematch of the US title match from WrestleMania. Matt Riddle gets an immediate rematch against Keith Lee. And the big main event of the evening, the Lashley title celebration. But that's just an aside. The show kicks off properly with Elias in the ring doing his usual stick. Him and Jackson Riker, where out comes enraged Drew McIntyre. He's lost the WWE title the night before. Well, lost his rematch for it, and he is annoyed. He pretty much comes out and batters Elias in the space of 5 minutes. Completely whitewashes him to start off the show, where he then takes the mic after the match and says he wants his title back, only for the lights to go out, and behind him is Aleister Black. Aleister Black lays out Drew McIntyre with a black mass, so we don't know if Drew's going to get what he wants in the title shot. We cut backstage where we see Charlotte and Rhea Ripley bickering over the fact that the two of them fell short on their triple threat match at the weekend against Asuka. When in comes old Strap Daddy himself, Adam Pearce. He pretty much says, you're bickering, you know, but the only one way we can get you to get along is for you to team up, as tonight you'll be challenging for the Women's Tag Team Championship. That'll be coming up later on. But we're then back in the ring where we're going to get a bit of an exhibition-style match between three of the most underutilized stars on the roster. Ricochet, Mustafa Ali, and Angel Garza will be having a triple threat match that goes on for about 8 minutes. And it's an exhibition of everything that all the superstars have to offer. But in that 8 minutes' time, it's Mustafa Ali who gets the victory. He pins Ricochet to get the win, and he is victorious in this match. We then go straight into another match. It's the match that was advertised, the rematch for the US title. It's Keith Lee versus Matt Riddle. Keith Lee is now the champion after WrestleMania. He's defending it for the first time. Pretty much the two of them go on for about 10 minutes. Hard-hitting contest where Keith Lee throws everything at Matt Riddle and he can't put him away. To which point we see a bit of frustration subtly from Lee as he exposes a turnbuckle that Matt Riddle doesn't see. So as Matt Riddle goes to charge him in the ring, Lee gets out the way, hits the turnbuckle, spirit bomb, bam. Keith Lee's retained the US title, but in nefarious means. Big question marks what that means. We then come in and AJ Styles is in the ring as he issues an open challenge. He's proclaiming he has beaten everybody one-on-one in the roster, and he's met by Andrade. Andrade comes out to face AJ Styles in a match that goes on about 14 minutes. The two of them are given an opportunity to showcase everything they have, and Andrade gets the upset, much to AJ Styles' annoyance. Andrade picks up the win here over AJ Styles. Next up, we get Randy Orton coming out to the ring for a promo. He is addressing what happened at the weekend where he fell short to Bray Wyatt, the Fiend. He says pretty much the only reason he lost that match is down to the smoking mirrors that the Fiend presents. And when it comes to an actual proper match of any type, he can beat anybody, be it somebody from the past or someone coming through the system. That's not the tease you may think, guys. No. It's somebody who's came through the system recently. Damian Priest comes out and he addresses Randy Orton. He's full of confidence. Him and Bad Bunny beat the Miz and Morrison the night before. They have a verbal exchange where Damian Priest says, Orton is complacent. He can put the foot off the gas. But when it comes to not taking the foot off the gas and being full steam ahead, Damian Priest is the man. He wants to be the best. And to prove it, he'll want to beat Randy Orton. So he says that anytime, any place, he'll take him on. To which Randy Orton says, you're going to have to prove yourself in the coming weeks. So we could see what happens there in terms of that. Bit of a tease for the pay-per-view ahead. We then get the U Day, who have come out to the ring. They've lost their tag team championships the night before. They want to get back in contention, though. So they said they're willing to go back the calendar and they're willing to face whoever comes out the curtain at this particular point. And that point, it's Eric and Ivar. Yes, the Viking Raiders have returned. 7 minute match the two of them these go for. One of the first times these two have ever got on, so it's a barn burner of a match, you know. They've not lost a step, the Viking Raiders, still hitting everything they go. and they get the win in this end. They've beaten the U-Day, so the U-Day are even further down the pecking order, but the Viking Raiders are right in for a shot at the Tag Team Championships. We then get a segment where Shane McMahon's entrance music starts to hit, but then it starts to blend. It blends into Braun Strowman's theme. He comes out, he's beaten Shane McMahon at WrestleMania, and he says that win has cemented his place as the most fearsome man in WWE. You may think he's a bit of talking a lot of rubbish, but hey-ho, that's what he thinks. And he's telling people. And he's met by Mustafa Ali. Mustafa Ali comes out leading Retribution to the ring. He pretty much says that, yes, Braun, you are what you say you are. However, you're underappreciated by the company. And for you to establish your true dominance, you need to join me and join Retribution. To which point that Braun, you can see in his face, he's thinking about it. He knows Ali's got a point, but instead of answering him, he simply walks away, leaving the open question, will Braun Strowman join Retribution and save that stable? We then get Drew Gulak. He's in the ring as he's ready to take on his match with John Morrison, who comes out with The Miz. As I said earlier, they lost the night before, so you can kind of see at this point, it's about 6 minutes the match goes on for. But you can kind of see The Miz is still doing his antics at ringside as he was at commentary talking up. But you can see a bit of frustration in John Morrison. He's getting a bit fed up with The Miz's antics. But Morrison's able to get the win, even though Miz is still, he's verbally criticising the commentator. It's annoying Morrison. So at the end of the match, even though he's won, he's still giving looks to The Miz. He doesn't know what's going to happen. He's a bit fed up with him. So we're seeing a bit of dissension between that team. We then get a vignette package from inside the Firefly Funhouse with Alexa Bliss and Bray Wyatt. They have pretty much said that they've had the fun with Randy Orton. They've shown he's just a pawn in their games now. They're ready to play games with other people. And it could be anybody, they say. It could be somebody right in their home here, or it could be someone who's a bit of a prince in other places. They're ready to have fun with anybody. So watch out, because he is ready to destroy people. And they love it. We then get the match for the Women's Tag Team Championships. It's Charlotte and Rhea versus Nia and Shayna. It's the main event portion of the main event match of the night. They're given 17 minutes and they go at it. Probably one of the best displays we probably see from Nia Jax. But the team of Charlotte and Rhea, they blend so well with the chemistry they've had in the past, and they get the win in this one. They are Tag Team Champions. Rhea Ripley's first main roster title. Now we've got the final portion of the night, the Lashley title celebration. The Hurt Business are in the ring. They've all got their gold, to which MVP is very talking them up. He says, we are going to dominate Raw for years and months to come. We are all champions. To which point, Brock Lesnar is here. Brock Lesnar comes out. He is coming to cash his shot. He wants what he lost a year ago. So he comes out, batters the tag champs, batters MVP, gets face to face with Lashley. He gets back, he's in the corner ready to go. When we get that kind of thing we saw in NXT a year or so ago, suddenly from out of nowhere behind him, Keith Lee's here. Keith Lee is behind Lesnar. Him and Lashley combined take out Brock Lesnar, destroy him, leave him in an absolute puddle on the floor. To which this Raw after Mania ends with all the gold, as all the Hurt Business and MVP stand over Brock Lesnar. The Hurt Business are here. Keith Lee is here, is heel, and they're ready to destroy Raw.
It's exciting. It's exciting. Two very good cards put up against each other. Two very similar cards in certain areas as well, which I think makes this even more difficult for me, but in some ways could offer me a clear road to clarity. Dave, I'm going to start with you. Just in a general sense, why do you think your card was better than Stephen's? Dave, you are muted. We've been in this pandemic for a year. Come on, guys. You know, Dave, why do you think your card was better than Stephen's?
My card is better because it ticks all the boxes. There's returns, there's title matches, there's looking forward to the next pay-per-view. There's an NXT call-up. There are heel turns. Everything you could want and expect from the Raw after Mania, which is often a chaotic show anyway. So for the lack, and I appreciate, you know, what makes it the most memorable show of the year is the fan participation. But obviously, because of the pandemic, no fans. So let's just throw absolutely as much as we can that logically makes sense whilst building a story towards the next pay-per-view, because, you know, we've just sort of let the dust settle with WrestleMania, but now we've got to look forward and say, okay, what's next? So what better way to do it than to hit the ground running, get two qualifier matches for the next pay-per-view, build for the weeks ahead, and also establish a single Raw Women's Champion with Rhea Ripley, who's been hyped for weeks, gets a definitive win over somebody who's basically calling out the system for not recognizing her talents as much. We have set records with the first ever three-time women's tag team champions. We have the two singles champions going against each other whilst furthering a storyline with a heel-turning Keith Lee and the Hurt Business only getting stronger. Like, what could you not like about this card? And also Adam Cole's on, and everybody loves a bit of Adam Cole.
Well, Stephen, the same question to you. Why is your card better than Dave's?
Well, see, with the Raw after WrestleMania, it is all about moving forward. But in terms of the pay-per-view, we're not as focused too much on the pay-per-view coming up in history of the Raw after Mania. We like to see something new, fresh, but we're kind of focused on the one night thing. And I kind of got that in different elements. We've got that with the guys such as, we've got Andrade getting a showcase. Aleister Black's put in a prominent position against a guy in Drew McIntyre, who still looks great, even though he's lost the title. I've got him in the returns as well. We've got the Viking Raiders. We've got Brock Lesnar, for goodness sake. And you've got pretty much the showcase of talent who are underutilized, who look as if they're going to be given a bit more of a platform. We had that triple threat match. Great showcase of those guys. Ali in a prominent position, kind of leading Retribution forward. And of course, my version of the Keith Lee Hurt Business stuff comes across as so much more dominant and so much more something that makes you shocked than guys beating up Matt Riddle. Come on. They beat up Brock Lesnar. That's enough. That's Brock Lesnar lying prone in the middle of the ring to end the show is box office in itself. And it makes people say, who are these guys who just beat up one of the most accomplished stars in professional sports?
So that was one of the areas that things overlapped. Another area, Dave, was the Viking Raiders. You had them going up against Celtic and Rangers, nor Cedric and Shelton in a match. Stephen had them going up against the New Day. Do you think there's a difference there? Why do you think your version is better? Like, how would you defend that or differentiate those two?
Well, Cedric and Shelton have been in a bit of a rut since losing the Raw tag team titles to New Day, and they've been struggling to sort of get their momentum going. But they're almost in a way sort of still relevant as a result of Bobby Lashley being associated with them and being a part of the Hurt Business as a whole as the most dominant faction on Raw. It gives them status and it gives them exposure. What the Viking Raiders does for this one is it brings them back in a way that, you know, they've been off TV for so long now that you almost forget how dominant they actually are. And to have that face heel dynamic of a returning dominant face team going over and getting one up on the most dominant faction on Monday Night Raw, it's a huge statement to bring the Viking Raiders back to Monday Night Raw, and it puts them straight in contention for our future Raw Tag Team Championship match.
I think I don't know if I'm convinced by that, and I don't know if I can differentiate between the two. It's a struggle, but I'll leave that one with me just now. Stephen, I'm going to go to you for the next similarity that the two of you had here. We had some women's tag team championship action. You know, Dave had Sasha and Bianca as defending champions after Mania, going up against Shayna and Nia, and Shayna and Nia walked out with the women's tag belts, compared to you, who had the losers of the Raw women's tag title match in your booking, Rhea and Charlotte, defeating Nia and Shayna for the belts. Same question, can you differentiate between the two? Why is yours better in this case?
Well, in my case, is that David is clearly focused too much on the Raw side of the SmackDown side of things with the Sasha Bianca type aspect of it. I don't think that's something that's really needed for the Raw. But I think with this, with my particular side of the booking, it still establishes these, because they've lost the match at WrestleMania, granted, but they still believe that they're good enough. They still believe they're good. That's why they're bickering. They still think, I would have won that if I was given this chance. So I think it kind of establishes them more in that aspect of it. Whereas I feel like doing the thing with Nia and Shayna again doesn't feel fresh. This feels a bit more repetitive aspect of it. And it's a match that people have seen 3 or 4 times probably, that particular match. You don't want to see that in the Raw after Mania. You want to see something new. You want to see something you've not seen as much. And I feel like that's what you're going to get with Charlotte and Rhea. They've been opponents before, but they've never kind of teamed together. It's something that's going to build towards something in the future.
Yeah, and I've got one last question to ask you here to help make up my mind. And Stephen, I'll come to you first to shake things up here. You touched on it in earlier points, but reiterate to me why you feel your version of the Keith Lee heel turn joining the Hurt Business is better than Dave's.
I feel like mine's is kind of seeded throughout the night. You get all of that, you get that kind of expectation with it. You've got Lee versus Riddle early in the night. It kind of closes off the bit between the two. Dave kind of does it similarly, but I feel like my bit takes away from that one. And then you've got the position where Keith Lee's instantly thrust into a bigger position in there with somebody like Brock Lesnar. Whereas if he was in there with somebody maybe like Matt Riddle, Matt Riddle's not a guy that's established as much, so it doesn't really take Keith Lee as much of a threat, I don't think. But I feel like this makes Keith Lee look like a bigger star, beating somebody like Brock Lesnar.
Okay, Dave, your chance to respond to that.
Yeah, I think the inclusion of Brock Lesnar is a little bit hasty, if I'm being honest, because that has the makings of a potential SummerSlam feud rather than a one that immediately follows WrestleMania. Well,
it doesn't need to follow. They've taken Brock Lesnar out, and Brock Lesnar could be out of action. We could not see Brock Lesnar for a while, you know. So it's not something they could just throw at the wall right away.
Well, if Brock Lesnar returned, what do you think the fans would be talking more about on Twitter? You know, are they going to talk about how dominant the Hurt Business been, or would they be saying, oh my God, Brock Lesnar's back, what are we going to talk? Like, this is meant to be about the Hurt Business growing, developing, and ascertaining dominance. And it's my version, you know, it builds off a pre-existing feud that they already had with Matt Riddle. Matt Riddle already has a one-up on Bobby Lashley and the Hurt Business, and he's starting to sort of take that very laid-back demeanor and poking the bear almost with it. And now,
let's be honest, Matt Riddle's get that much, you know, cred about it, that he brings these two guys in at the start of his show, and then when are they at the end of the show when he's getting beat up? You know, so you brought these guys back as people who are meant to help Matt Riddle, and they're nowhere, you know.
They respect him enough to know that, you know, he can handle, you know, any sort of stipulation on his own. And he has other friends who he originally thought in the form of Keith Lee. That's what makes the heel turn so much more effective, because Matt and Keith are good friends, you know, supposed to be, you know, backstage. But then this happens, it's as if, you know, Riddle's just been absolutely sucker punched, and now Keith Lee is on the side of the guys he's been fighting against. It's classic heel face dynamic with a swerve, which, you know, amplifies the dominance of the Hurt Business.
We need to end it there. I eventually just sat back because Stephen was, you know, you interrupted Dave there, but I liked the back and forth. He's went at it. I allowed it. Let it happen. You know, referees, you know, they've got to play hard and fast with the rules sometimes, you know, when the match calls for it. And this is the type of environment that calls for it, I think. And you both held your own there in that exchange. I have to look at this a bit holistically, because I think in the lower card, there's things that I really liked about what both of you did, and there's some things that I didn't like as much. For example, Dave, you set up the story of Money in the Bank. I do think that's one way to go with it. The match of Sheamus versus Priest intrigues me. The match of Styles versus Braun intrigues me in a way. You know, you've also got a women's championship match in there. Ripley against Peyton, which I think was a good addition to the card. Like you said, it brought a nice through line to things, you know, setting up Money in the Bank. Not entirely sure of what the gap is between them, but it could be a good use of time. And similarly with Stephen, he gave us some guys who don't really get the TV time. You know, we've got Gulag getting a spotlight there. Like you said, Andrade beating AJ was a big plus as well. Ricochet, Ali, and Garza in a triple threat. Now, that is something. That is something as well. The way both of you used Drew was interesting. Drew versus Elias doesn't, on the one hand, doesn't fill me with much joy. You know, it doesn't bring me joy in my life, so I could get rid of that. However,
you need somebody who's going to batter. That's what he's there for. He's something about.
To kick off the show, I don't know, but the post-match angle at the same time, you know, was very good. You know, similarly, Dave, I'm intrigued by the psychopath character coming back. However, at the same time, Drew, with Miz and Morrison, is that the best way to use Miz and Morrison? Arguably, Stephen used Morrison better later in the show. But like I said, it's kind of six and half a dozen. So I had to go to key areas, and some of them were very close as well. I think there's good cases to be made for the women's tag matches that both of you included there. And it's just, you know, like I said, it's tit for tat. It's two different stories. I didn't particularly like how both of you used them as a way for singles feuds, not real tag teams, maybe a problem with that division. Viking Raiders, again, there was no argument there that was going to separate those for me. I think it was a great return from injury for both of you with the Viking Raiders. I really appreciate that for both of you. However, both of you used it. So, you know, there's not much I can do to separate that there. What it does come down to, I think, is what is at the essence of the Raw after Mania, and that is the surprise. You both had a similar story with the Hurt Business. You both had Keith Lee turn heel and join the Hurt Business. That much is true. Dave, you had Adam Cole called up. On its own, a very good thing. Stephen, you had Brock Lesnar return. On its own, some might say, not a good thing, depending who you are. You know? The difference here for me is the way they were used. And Dave, you had Adam Cole come up and go into a match with Jackson Ryker on the mid-card, which to me, as a fan, I would be worried about in the first night, because what is Adam Cole standing within the company? Sure, he's got a Money in the Bank qualifier the next week, but he's also entering into a feud with Elias as his first feud.
I'll admit that was a risk, but I think it's the best way to sort of draw him into the more mainstream audience.
It's a risk, and was a risk.
And what do I know about, you know, taking risks? Because I play it safe all the time. Am I right?
Stephen, however, had Lesnar come out, and I didn't agree with your argument that people would be talking about Lesnar. People would be talking about the fact that Lashley and Keith Lee battered Lesnar. Who are these guys? In terms of the surprise, Stephen had the better surprise. And because of that, the winner of the Booker T Trophy and the final of the inaugural Book It tournament is Mr. Stephen Wilson. Stephen Wilson wins the Booker T. Rophy. Congratulations to the champ. Congratulations to the winner. Before we talk to Stephen Wilson, Dan, if you could take Stephen off the screen for me quickly. I'm going to speak to Dave. Commendations to our runner-up here. Dave, a hard-fought battle. A hard-fought tournament. I think what it came down to is you both had very similar ideas for the shows. Yeah, as we've seen, like almost identical in certain places. But Stephen just edged you there. How do you feel about not only this final, but your efforts throughout the entire Book It tournament?
You know what? I'm not mad at all. I think I'm just happy to have, you know, done a number of really good, you know, fantasy booking cards, and I know I am capable of doing it. The Raw after Mania, you know, it's a very tricky show to produce because, you know, anything can happen. Mm. I went with an approach that, you know, I figured, you know, would be the most realistic, and, you know, try and throw a few in surprises in there, get an NXT call up like they usually do. But I took a risk with the way we booked Adam Cole, and unfortunately it didn't pay off. But hey ho, that's the risk of booking it.
And I have to say, from your first match, you improved with Ross. I think you did well here. Like you said, you took some chances. I'll be happy to see you back. Like we said, we're going to be booking this like a fight sport going forward. You can earn your way back into contention for that trophy. A lot of newbies coming in. Perhaps you could take on someone like Grant McRobbie. you know, who Steven faced in the first round to try and prove your strengths. Perhaps it is a newbie. Perhaps it's a Chris Murray. Perhaps it's an Andy Mitchell, you know, who you could have in the horizon. There's a lot of interesting matchups out there. Is there anyone specifically that you would like to go up against maybe in the future to try and get yourself back to the upper echelon?
I think for now, I'll probably just go back to the drawing board, you know, sort of reset my brain, have a look at, you know, a variety of promotions, see what I can draw from it, and then I'll come back with a much more refreshed approach, maybe a good mix of, you know, safe decisions, some smart decisions, and maybe a few risks taken here and there. But when I do come back, I'll be happy to go up against any challenger.
Listen, and we will have you back, and I have a match to offer you. I will give you a mail, my friend. David Haughney, everyone, the runner-up in the inaugural Book It tournament. We'll see you later, Dave. Dan, if you want to bring back the first ever holder of the Booker T. Rophy, it is the winner of this tournament. It is Mr. Stephen Wilson, the founder, is here, and he is back as the champion.
My substitute trophy here, that's the first thing I can grab.
I love it. Stephen, when you heard Dave go first, and you're looking at your card and you're thinking, there's a lot on here that's similar to mine. What was going through your head at that moment?
Well, I thought the Viking Raiders thing, I thought initially he's done that not bad. I've just got them coming out with a U Day kind of idea. But yeah. I thought when he didn't have them have some involvement in that main event angle, I thought there was it's an OG because it just doesn't, it's... Yeah. You should need to have them. I know he went with the Keith Lee thing. I can understand his way, but you could have had day two come out, fought them off, and the Keith Lee thing could have happened then.
Yeah.
But I feel like, I think I've done throughout this tournament, David, is my big moments, I think I've hit well. And I think I've kind of structured my show around about these big moments, because that was the kind of thing. I thought, Raw after Mania, what's one of the biggest things that's happened in the Raw after Mania for years? And Brock Lesnar's return in 2012 was the thing that stood out to me.
Yeah.
And the fact he's been gone for so long, he's somebody who would keep them talking. And I think I could have done that, but the thing as well with the Raw after Mania, you've got to hook them with the things and coming up beneath it. I think the kind of the high-octane type wrestling type idea of it combined with a couple of angles would have helped. I'll be honest, the tag title match, I was dying just to chuck to Charlotte and Rhea in somehow. And I thought that was a good... I just wanted to try and get the belts off of Nia and Shayna in some sort of booking. But
Fair enough. Well, it worked out for you in the end. You are, like I said, the first ever winner of the Booker T. Rophy. And you will be defending that trophy. You'll be defending that honour. You know, like, this is going to become like a fight sport sort of booking. And I can tell you, a number one contenders match has been booked to face you. And it's a very interesting one for you because your old adversary, Strack, is in that contenders match against Ross McLeod. That will be the number one contenders match. What are you thinking about that one?
David, come on. I need a challenge, man. Come on. You've got PlayStation version Drew Gulak, you know, against the man who preps while he has his macaroni. I'm going to put these bits for this bit. I feel like you've just kind of... You started very high. You gave me Grant to start with, which was a bit of a spanner, because Grant can throw things and no one else can. Yeah. And there was Strack, and then, you know, as I've mentioned, me beating Dave's a formality. You know, Wilson beat Hopney, he's going to go and blimmin' everything that David does in his life. You know, he's going to be watching telly. He's going to be watching telly later. He's going to be watching telly later that's just going to say, Wilson beats Hopney.
I won't reverse this decision. That's despicable.
Sorry. Fair play to Dave. He did well.
But listen, I think...
You respect the heel gimmick as much as anybody, David.
I really do. And I do think that you'll be a good inaugural holder of that trophy for this show. I can't wait to see who you have up against you coming forward. We have a couple of matches on the docket. Newbies coming in. Sarah Grieve will be competing in Book It. She will be entering the fray. Two people you know very well, Gary and Derek, will be entering the fray also in the Book It sense. It's going to be very interesting. Is there anyone in the world of ESSR who you would be worried about stepping foot into the Book It arena?
There is probably, I would probably say, it all depends, David, I think, on the topic that you throw at us. I think some of the, some of the topics that you gave the other guys, I might have struggled with them, I think, to be fair. I got the there's a couple of good cards for me, I think, in terms of the Evolution card and the AEW card. So this was like what I was most worried about the freeze. So depending on how that kind of goes, if you kind of go, I would love to face one of the two Kiernans. You know how much pain they've got? take the pain that Dave has felt from me when he watches my promo and maybe like multiply, you know. It's equivalent, like I'm an only child. These two are kind of like the closest thing I've got to brothers, you know. Wow. Used to double choke Sammy on their mum's couch all the time, you know. I like to one up them, you know. So there's a lot of credible stuff in there. Sarah's got similar to Grant. She can throw curveballs at you that you don't in certain aspects of it. Chris, just talk about names you mentioned there. Chris has got a good solid knowledge about things, you know. There is loads of guys. But in hell, you could throw Quacko in there at a comedy wrestling card, and I think you'd do me. So yeah.
We'll see. We need to see how things work out. But for today, Stephen Wilson, the winner of the tournament and the holder of the Booker T. Rophy, congratulations to the founder. He will go forth. Book It will go forth. I can't wait to see you back next time. And I can reveal that match, you've seen a segment at the start of this show, Sarah Grieve being very arrogant in the fact that she'll take on any comer. Well, I can tell you the next match you'll see in Book It will be Sarah Grieve. Don't come in my show and expect me to tell you things. Sarah Grieve versus a mystery opponent. Up yours, Sarah. We'll see you later on.